Welcome to Crossing Zero. I'm Paul Fitzgerald.
My name is Liz Gould.
A program based on our book published by City Lights, Crossing Zero, the AFPAC War at the Turning Point of American Empire. Crossing Zero will bring the crisis in Afghanistan and Pakistan into sharp focus by introducing the people, the arguments, and the issues currently raging around America's longest-running war, as well as what every American needs to know for analyzing the politics and history of the AFPAC region and how they affect America's future. The region today, delineated as both Afghanistan and Pakistan, has known many borders over the millennia. Yet none have been more artificial or contentious than the one separating Pakistan and Afghanistan, known as the Durand Line, but referred to by the military and intelligence community as Zero Line. Afghanistan has known many borders over the millennia, yet none have been more artificial than the one today separating Pakistan from Afghanistan, known as the Durand Line, but referred to by the military and intelligence community as Zero Line. The Durand Line was originally named after British India's Foreign Secretary, Sir Henry Mortimer Durand. In 1893, it established a boundary between British India and Afghanistan after two Anglo-Afghan wars and a Russian expansion that resulted in a virtual stalemate for both sides. The British and Russian empires had reached their territorial limits and wished to avoid a direct confrontation. Following over a half century of competition for control of Central Asia, known as the Great Game, the Durand Line established Afghanistan as a neutral buffer state between rival empires. From the perspective of the Afghan Pashtuns living on both sides of the arbitrary border, the Durand Line was a horrific division of peoples who for at least 3,000 years had been considered part of the Afghan homeland. The first formulation of Afghan nationality can be traced to the 16th century. Led by Sufi poet Bayezid Ansari, his revolt against the Mughal Empire is a major chapter in the region's Pashtun history, as well as indicative of the progressive nature of Afghan Islam. Prior to British invasions of the mid-19th century, Afghans were welcoming to European visitors. They expressed an open tolerance towards Christians. East India Company political officer Alexander Burns wrote in 1832, quote, "The people of this country are kind-hearted and hospitable. They have no prejudice against the Christian and none against our nation." This changed when 15,000 British and Indian troops attacked in 1839 in the first of three attempts to incorporate Afghanistan into the British Empire. Misjudging the Afghans' determination to expel the invaders, by 1841 the British occupation was doomed. The military retreat resulted in the greatest defeat in British history. Despite an official rebuke from London for the invasion, a similar mistake was repeated in 1878 when 35,000 British troops attacked again. The British attack initially appeared successful. A hasty agreement forced the Afghans to surrender districts bordering India and gave the British the authority to negotiate Afghanistan's borders and foreign policy. But by 1880, the British began to fear that history was repeating itself and invited a popular Afghan leader, Abdul Rahman Khan, to assume the throne. Known as the Iron Amir, he set the foundations for a modern Afghan state. The Amir always contended that he could control the tribes better than the British, but under protest, he was forced to accept British-imposed borders. In 1893, the British Foreign Secretary for India, Sir Henry Mortimer Durand, imposed an artificial border line between India and Afghanistan down the middle of the Hindu Kush. Following Abdul Rahman's reluctant acceptance of the Durand Line in 1893, Britain then created a threefold frontier of separation from Russia's South Asian Khanates. The conquered territory on the eastern side of the Hindu Kush Mountains was broken up into five tribal regions under the direct control of the British government in Delhi. The Durand Line officially deprived the Amir of land east of the Hindu Kush and of the most strategic mountain passes west of it. The line had a profound effect on the development of Afghanistan's culture and economy by cutting Afghanistan's access routes to the Arabian Sea through Baluchistan, leaving the country landlocked and dependent on the British Empire. On the British side of the border, severe penal laws known as the Frontier Crimes Regulations were reenacted in order to control the population. These laws were adapted from English laws introduced into Ireland in 1366 to stop the Anglo-Norman population from intermarrying with the native Irish. The Frontier Crimes Regulations are to this day administered by a political agent who retains absolute feudal powers as the judge, jury, police chief, warden, district magistrate, and public prosecutor. The Anglo-Russian Entente of 1907 ended the Great Game for Central Asia by dividing Persia into three zones: British in the south, Russian in the north, and a neutral buffer zone in between. But then in 1919, Afghanistan's Amir, Amanullah Khan, declared a holy war of independence from Britain. He provoked an uprising on both sides of the border that resulted in the third Anglo-Afghan War that ended with the signing of the Treaty of Rawalpindi on August 8, 1919. Despite guaranteeing Afghanistan's independence, Britain refused to renegotiate the Durand Line. King Amanullah then pushed ahead for modernization, and by 1923 had instituted Afghanistan's first constitution, which guaranteed universal suffrage, civil rights to minorities, established a legislative assembly, courts, penal, civil, and commercial codes. He prohibited revenge killings and abolished subsidies for tribal chieftains and the royal family. Even though support for his modernization efforts was growing, Amanullah's reforms were doomed because of Afghanistan's colonially starved economy, which lacked the capacity to meet the demands of most social, political, or economic growth. Throughout the 20th century, Afghanistan's political options remained severely hampered by this lack of economic development. With the departure of the British from the region after World War II, Afghanistan hoped to cultivate an alliance with the United States. Instead, the creation of Pakistan in 1947 only furthered British colonial policy, pitting tribe against tribe while honoring the artificial colonial boundaries that kept the region in constant conflict. The Durand Line had been devised in 1893 to provide Britain with a buffer zone against the territorial advances of Russia. Now the Durand Line was used to create the western border of Pakistan for the same purposes, maintaining a strategic military zone that would now be guaranteed by the United States. By 1973, the legacy of Afghanistan's colonial boundaries, its inability to satisfy the needs of its population, and the lack of a political or economic infrastructure to manage the country's advancement hobbled King Zahir's efforts to advance modernization. When former Prime Minister Mohammad Daoud staged a palace coup against his cousin the king, there was little protest. Daoud immediately encountered the same problems whenever he questioned the legitimacy of the Durand Line. Daoud offered nationalist insurgents on the Pakistani side a cross-border sanctuary from the Pakistani military. Pakistan responded by harboring and training 5,000 Islamist guerrillas, including Ahmad Shah Massoud and Gulbuddin Hekmatyar, for a campaign of destabilization. The Pakistan-trained guerrilla network would grow into a full-blown counter-revolutionary force supported by the United States following the 1978 Marxist coup that toppled the government of Mohammad Daoud. The issue came to a head with the Soviet invasion of 1979.
Afghanistan. War in the Hindu Kush. A war fought by the Soviet Union to prevent the spread of Islamic fundamentalism. Like Vietnam, a conflict dominated by the helicopter gunship. Unlike Vietnam, a hit-and-run guerrilla war, not all rebels could agree how to win. And one fought in often atrocious conditions for which the Soviets were untrained and unprepared.
But unlike other hotspots of the Cold War competition, America's unqualified support for Pakistan's war on Afghanistan brought with it the long-standing ethnic and political time bomb known as the Durand Line.
This is ABC News Nightline.
It's more than 3 years since the Soviet Union invaded Afghanistan and installed its current Marxist regime in power. During those years, civil war has continued unabated. There have been charges of atrocities, the Soviets have been accused of using chemical weapons, and there are more Soviet troops in that country today than at the time of the original invasion. Through it all, neither side has gained much ground, and attempts at negotiation have gotten nowhere. In effect, a military and political stalemate. Under these circumstances, earlier this month, a television news team headed by American freelance journalist Paul Fitzgerald was granted permission to spend 10 days in Marxist-controlled Afghanistan. For part of that time, they were accompanied by one of America's leading experts on crisis negotiation, Professor Roger Fisher of Harvard University. Here now is their exclusive report narrated by Paul Fitzgerald.
One of the things about Afghanistan, I think, that is both the most appealing and the most stunning to an American particularly, is the fact that it is probably one of the most untouched places in the world. It really is like stepping back into the 15th, 16th century in terms of what you see. Women in chowdhury, as an example. You'll see Dove soap and Pepsodent toothpaste or any number of American or Western products in a bazaar. And the shop right next door, where they're making bread the same way they made it 2,000 years ago, with one individual wrapped up in cloths to avoid burning himself as he dipped his hand down into the oven. Afghan weddings are very elaborate affairs. When you look up on the hillsides and you see those villages there, and you look up at the wall that surrounds the city that was built 500 or 600 years ago to protect against invaders, you begin to get a feel for what life is really like there. In how very little life has changed in the last 1,000, 2,000 years.
Many Afghans, especially in the countryside, perceive the new Marxist government as anti-Islamic in a country that's very religious and virtually 100% Muslim.
There are two simple versions of what's taking place here. The official government of Afghanistan version is that the only problem is intervention from Pakistan, funded by the CIA and other Westerners, seeking to overthrow this government. They say that if that intervention stopped, then the Russians would go home and all would be peaceful and quiet. Another simple version is that this is a case of Soviet aggression. 100,000 Soviet troops are said to be here, bombing villages and trying to suppress the resistance of the Afghanistan people. Neither of those simple versions is the whole story. But caught between these are the people of Afghanistan. The Prime Minister told us half the schools in this country have been destroyed, half the hospitals.
What is your most serious security problem in the area? Are the roads open?
Yes, the roads are open. But in the remote places, in the mountains and somewhere, they are the bandits, the terrorists are coming and terrorizing the people.
The Prime Minister was referring to rebels like these in the hills near the Pakistan border. In this film, shot by a West German cameraman, the rebels appear to have captured two Russian tanks and killed four soldiers. The war has reached into Kabul itself, as these videotapes from Afghan television demonstrate. During the past 6 months, there's been a rash of bombings in restaurants and at one movie house frequented by government bureaucrats. Government officials hold the U.S. at least partly responsible for the step-up in terrorism in Kabul.
The Soviet forces are helping us against the intervention and against the interference from abroad. It is quite obvious that it's supported, that it has been launched by the United States of America.
In March, a huge anti-American demonstration was staged outside the U.S. Embassy in Kabul. It was a protest against President Reagan's announcement of support for what he called the Mujahideen Freedom Fighters, but what the Afghan government calls criminal bandits. We were told that this was one of those criminal bandits, Malang, a guerrilla leader who turned himself in under the government's amnesty program along with a number of his followers. It was a coup for the government, and Malang's defection was broadcast on Afghan television. Later, we visited Malang himself in his home village, 25 miles outside Kabul. He's now a